Welcome, friends, to this second session of our after Bhandara meeting, in which we evaluated this morning. And I was very happy that so many of you found this event beneficial and helped you in your progress on the spiritual path. All right, we'll have a test now, whether you passed or not. Test is very simple. Now, the master is remembered by your soul. The person who remembers God, the Lord, masters, master power, spiritual power, his true home, Satkhand, those who remember that are known as Gurmukhs. Gurmukh means a follower of a guru, a follower of the truth. And those who follow the mind are called Manmukhs. Manmukhs are those who follow the man or the mind. So mind remembers things which are only related to the mind, and God is remembered by the soul. So in this test we are going to do now, you are going to meditate. And as I said earlier, we'll see if you only remember the jokes, then you fail. If you remember the master and forget the jokes, you pass. If you remember the master telling you these jokes, you get super marks. So let's see. Let's close our eyes. Go back to the third eye center behind the eyes. And allow the mind to roam around and see where it goes, where is drawn, where is your soul drawn, where is your attention drawn. Are you being dragged by the mind into something else, or are you able to focus on the master? Are you able to recall events with the master? Stay in the center, behind the eyes, and relax in the chair, and then recall. Keep your eyes closed till I count five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Open your eyes. Welcome back. Now we have to look at the test results. How many of you remembered the jokes only? Only one out of so many? How many remembered the master only? Very good. How many remembered the master telling the joke? Wow, you all passed. Congratulations. This is just a way to remind us there are so many things that the mind gets absorbed in. But we have the power to pull our attention away from what the mind is thinking and draw it inside to ourselves. The only external thing that we have which is identical to our real self and available at all levels, including physical level, is a perfect living master. It's an identical copy of the self, because the awareness of that person is the same as totality of awareness inside us. So if we have to find an identical copy or a copy of the creator is sitting outside, and when you go inside, it's also an identical copy. When you go higher up, it's still an identical copy. When you go to the top, it's the same. It's only one. There's no difference. So that is why we have in our own consciousness the power to put attention on anything we like. If we are dragged away by a mind to do what the mind wants to do, how can we be so helpless that we have so much power in our soul, in our spirit, that we can overrule everything? We are the creative power, and how can we be dragged away by a mind? Therefore, we must build into ourselves that strength of our own soul, called the spiritual strength, the spiritual will, that should be able to override the mind at any time. It does not mean don't use the mind. Use the mind, but you direct the mind where you want to use it. You want to think of a particular thing, direct the mind to think only of that. Nothing else. Meditation is not necessarily to close your eyes and sit and do it. It's a daily occurrence every time. 24/7 you can be meditating by using your spiritual awareness to override your mind. This test is an example how our mind can be diverted and our attention can be diverted wherever we like. Of course, in the beginning, when you want to use your spiritual will, you have to talk. You have to talk to yourself. The mind says, let me do it. You have to talk and say, no. That's also a word. Both, I want to do it, and the word no are both coming from the mind. You are using the mind for both purposes. You are allowing the mind to think on its own and do things, and you are also using the mind to say no to it. But when you say no, it is some other power that is overriding the mind. You are using the mind and its will against itself, and that only happens because the soul wants to assert itself. I am here, I am the consciousness, I am the owner of everything, and I own the mind, and why is the mind trying to boss over me? This attitude that we can build continuously, day and night, every time we make so many decisions, all the time this awareness should be with us, that we have to develop the spiritual will to overcome the mind's will and use the mind. We should use our mind, use our senses, use our body. They're all given for us to use. They're not given to us that we be dragged by them. What is happening is they're dragging us around. The story of a great master used to tell the story of a king who loved his daughter and wanted her to get married to another prince and live in a nice place in a royal style like she was accustomed to living. Somehow he went out and fell in love with the janitor of a low caste. And the king was very perturbed. And he said, look, she lost her whole lifestyle. She's living with that poor fellow. Poor fellow cleaning streets, cleaning houses. That poor fellow, what will he take care of my daughter? Very perturbed. But the daughter was in love with this cheapy guy. But the worst thing was that she loved the cheapy guy, and the cheapy guy, that poor fellow, did not even love her. He just took her as a wife and loved other women, prostitutes. He would go to one prostitute after another, and he had 5 prostitutes he used to go to. The life of that daughter of the king was miserable. This is our story. We are children of the Creator, living in spiritual style and spiritual palaces. We have lived that great life. We are supposed to live that great life at all times. And what did we do? We fell in love with this cheapy thing called mind. And we are following the mind. Mind doesn't love us. Mind loves things. Mind loves the 5 senses, the 5 prostitutes. The mind is being dragged. One prostitute drags the mind, goes away. One sense drags us, we go there. The eyes drag us somewhere, we go there. The lustful thoughts come, we go there. The possessive things come, we go there. The angry thoughts come, we go angry. That's what we are living our life with. Look at the purity of our consciousness, where it belonged, and how we ended up in this. It's better to get out of this mess, because there is no real love here. We have to withdraw ourselves where we belong. And therefore, our true home, which is royal, regal, palatial, where we can really enjoy and appreciate true bliss, where we can enjoy what true nature of consciousness is, what love comes from, where it comes from, where true knowledge comes from. That's where we should be going back. So that is why the spiritual path is a means to reassert our real identity. This is not our identity. This is a borrowed identity, and we think we are that just because we wanted to see a show and put on a costume to be a part of the show does not mean we become the show. It's temporary. Let's act according to the costume. We have to. That's why we came. But never lose sight of the fact we are actors wearing costumes. These are three powerful, beautiful, wonderful costumes, but they are costumes. The soul is covered with the costume of the mind. And the soul, which is pure consciousness, has gone into thinking because the mind thinks. I am thinking, the self is thinking. Self need not think, self knows everything. Why would it think? If the self is all-knowing, why would it think? Thinking is just to expand awareness into experience and to make it a different kind of experience. We take in the costume to be our own reality. And then top of that, the sense perceptions are the only means to go to know who we are. Sense perceptions are the only identity we have, another costume. And the physical body, that's the only reality. Sense perceptions are built into it. The mind is a function of the brain, and there's no independent thing. It's all physical stuff. The whole world is physical. It's only reality. We're caught up in this. Okay, there's a claim some people are making. But there's a better way to check it out. Go within and find out if it is true or not. Find out these are costumes that we are covering ourselves with or not. So once you actually start the journey, I am not saying, please go to Sachkhand tomorrow. I am saying, go on the correct route, go to the railroad station from where you can catch a train. Go to the airport where a plane can be taken. Go to the third eye center behind the eyes. Collect your attention there. You will be taken from there by your master. But you must check it out. You can't keep it merely as a good idea that we understood very well. It was very good. Intellectually, we have grasped the whole thing. And then we don't do anything. This is a very experiential path. It is not a path of belief, certainly not of blind belief. It's a path where you are indicated this is possible. Have a look. If you find what you're looking for, some signs are there, move forward. If you find more signs, more evidence of what you're looking for, move forward. It's scientific exploration of the self, of consciousness. And therefore, don't treat it as we went to a nice Bhandara and we had a good time, food was good. I remember in the 60s I came to this country to study in the university here and attended a few Bhandaras of the Satsangis. They were Satsangis of different masters from India. Most of them were from India. And they would say, we had a wonderful Bhandara. I said, really, how was it? Food was excellent. The whole emphasis on Bhandara was how good the food was. So what about meditation? Oh yeah, they said we should meditate regularly. Is that the priority we give to a Bhandara? Bhandara is the Bhandar of the grace which we can adopt, which many of you experienced. In the personal interviews you have told me how many experiences you had during one day. You can have the more experiences if you carry with you this whole simple truth. We all have access to our inner self, and it starts from behind the eyes at the third eye center. Put your attention there, even 5 minutes, with great intensity, with the kind of joy which you got from the jokes, I say, with the kind of enthusiasm and with the kind of passion that you have for something you really like to find out. If you place yourself behind the eyes 5 minutes in the morning when you get up, your whole day will be different. If you spend 5 minutes at night putting your attention there, your night will be different. Your day and night can change with 5 minutes. Out of 24 hours, people say you should give 1/10 of your time to meditation, 1/10 of your income to charity, 1/10 of this, share everything. And I am saying 10 minutes? Why am I reducing it from 2.5 hours minimum requirement to 10 minutes? Because we are living in Kali Yuga, Iron Age. In Iron Age, we can't do what was done in previous yugas. The more we are distracted by modern civilization, more we are distracted by modern technology, more we are drawn outward, the more difficult it's becoming for us to go inside. So I am only saying, it is better to do 5 minutes. Of course, if you can 2.5 hours, great. If you can do 8 hours, better. But we can't do that. So I am trying to be realistic. I am trying to be as realistic as possible. In the circumstances in which we live, we have so much, our lives have become so busy. We are so busy with so many things. We have taken on responsibilities which never existed before. We have taken on so much, and technology has brought us to high-speed living. And therefore, more and more of our time has been tied up. So that is why I am saying, at least 5 minutes in the morning, 5 minutes at night, and you will get results. But do it every day. Do not lose the momentum of it. Don't do it once a week. Don't say, I'm catching up now for all the time that I missed out. It takes a very long time to catch up. But slowly building up every day. And watch out. If every day you have one small little new experience, you are making progress. Very little experience, you're making progress. The experience need not be an internal vision. Some people think the only test of spirituality is what you can see inside. Not at all. Inside and outside are the same. How can you only confine yourself to one side? If you are seeing a miracle inside and you're seeing a miracle outside, they are identical. There's no difference. If something miraculous is happening in your life outside, how can you consider it less important than seeing a couple of stars inside? Don't make that mistake of thinking the only way to judge if you are making spiritual progress is to see what you saw inside in meditation. I told you this story of great master's master, Baba Jamal Singh. I'll repeat it. Just in case you've forgotten, I'll repeat it. Baba Jamal Singh was a disciple of Swamiji's, Seth Shivdayal Singh Ji of Agra, who set up the Radha Swami movement. And he was living in Punjab, and his master was living in Uttar Pradesh, another state in Agra. Long distance to travel in those days. But he was missing his master so much that he wrote a letter to Baba Jamal Singh. And he said, "Beloved master, I am missing you so much. I want to come and see you. I can't help it. I don't know what's happening. I am missing so much. Please give me a time and date when I can come and see you." And he mailed that letter. There was no other way of communication. No iPhones. No SMS. No iMessage. None of those stuff. Letters took a long time in those days. I think they carried by horseback or something, even the letters. After a month, a reply comes to him. "My beloved son, Jamal Singh, I am very happy to receive your letter and to know that your soul is roaming around in the higher regions, is going about in Khand Brahmand, puzzled by this letter." Jamal Singh said, "This is not meant for me. Maybe by mistake it has been mailed to my address, meant for some other disciple." So he wrote back. He said, "Master, my soul goes nowhere. I am just missing you. I can't help missing you so much. I want to see you right now. Please give me some time so I can come and see you." After a month, another letter comes back to him from Swamiji. He says, "Dear son Jamal Singh, I am very happy to receive your second letter. And I am very happy to know that your soul is roaming around in the higher regions in Khand Brahmand." Now puzzled completely by two letters. Swamiji writes, "So far as coming to see me is concerned, you can come in the first week of next month." So Baba Jamal Singh travels to Agra and goes and meets his master, Swamiji, with those two letters in his hand. And he presents them to him. Says, "Swamiji, you wrote these two letters to me, master. They don't belong to me. My soul never went anywhere. And you are writing twice that I am roaming around in Khand Brahmand." And Swamiji laughs at him and says, "Okay, put the letter aside. Let's go inside for a little while." There were some 10, 15 people sitting there outside. So they both retire into a room inside. After about half an hour, they both come out. And then in the presence of others, Swamiji says, Jamal Singh, now tell me, when I wrote those letters to you, was your soul going round in Khand Brahman in higher region or not? He said, yes, Master, it was. Swamiji says, I am not asking you whether your soul went into Khand Brahman today when we went inside the room. I am asking you, was your soul roaming around in Khand Brahman in higher regions when I wrote the letters to you? Yes, Master, it was roaming around at that time. Then Swamiji addressed those people sitting around. He said, it is not always necessary to have a spectacle insight to know what progress you have made. The fact that this son of mine, Baba Jamal Singh, felt so missing so much, expressing love so strongly, where was that coming from? You cannot have that feeling unless some progress spiritually is being made. Because what is drawing the soul inside to a higher level is the love and devotion you are expressing and the feeling. The feeling that he could express his love by saying he missed so much, he wanted to see his master immediately, showed the soul was making progress inside. Then Swamiji also explained, this is like putting a bandage on your eyes so that you are not drawn to that spectacle forever. And you are able to do those things which are required to do with your karmic responsibilities here. He explained that we have to do so many things, and although we are seekers of the truth and want to move inside, we have karmically created responsibility, karmically created obligations to do a lot of things, taking care of our jobs, our families, children, parents, things like that. We have so many things to do outside. And if all the time we are seeing inner spectacles, we would not be able to do that and come back again to take care of those people. Therefore, it's better that we keep on paying off our karma, at the same time make ascent. In order to pay off your karma, very often you have to put attention on those things which a spectacle inside can remove. But this does not mean that you are making no progress. Progress can be measured by many means. This is just one example I have given you, that when you feel you miss your master so much, you love him so much, you want to be close to him, you are making progress. When you see little miracles in your life, you are making progress. And I'll tell you some other standards. If you are less angry than you used to be, you are making progress. If you are less lustful than you used to be, you are making progress. If you think this world is not yours, not attached so much, you are making progress. When you feel that, who are you? Only Master is the doer of all things, and you think of it all the time, you are making progress. These are all signs. There are so many other ways to check if you are making spiritual progress or not. Spiritual progress is being made continuously while these things are happening. And how peaceful and calm you are. How do you deal with people? Are you provoked as easily as you used to be? All these are signs. There's so many ways to judge. Spiritual progress is change in spiritual life. It changes in so many things in your life. That's how you can judge. But sometimes we ask this question, and people have asked, if we have found a master, we have to go through home, why does it take so long? It should be just now, instant. We should go instantly back to Sachkhand. Why are we wasting time here? What does the master's point of view say there to that question? He says, what I am doing for you is like an instant. You've been here millions and millions of years. You've been lifetime after lifetime. And the fact that I am going to take you in a few years, in a short lifetime, is like an instant. You know, the time is different. In true home, the time is very different. For example, you can have a whole lifetime here, which will be an instant there. So one lifetime means nothing. Master's point of view is from a different level. This reminds me of somebody telling me a story about Brahma and a disciple of the Creator. Disciple prayed, Lord, is it true that in your domain, 1,000 years is just a moment? Brahma said, yes, dear, that is true. Is it also true that in your domain, $1 million is 1 cent? He says, that is true. Lord, will you give me 1 cent from your domain? And Brahma said, wait a moment. But the whole essence of the story is, we cannot always judge from the small time frame we have what we are getting. We don't remember our past lives. We don't remember anything. We are only living in a short span, and we are taking that and becoming impatient in that. Being impatient in a short span of time, when we have so much, and there are some rules. We have designed, this is a world of law, laws and rules and regulations, the mental world. These worlds, physical, astral and causal, are mental worlds. They operate under the laws of the mind. Cause and effect, they are based upon karma. This is the kind of world we are in now. That's what we are experiencing now. So while we are experiencing this world, we go according to the rules of this world. I can't go and cause a traffic problem and tell the cop, no, I am on spiritual path. Don't give me a ticket. I have to follow the rules of this world. Similarly, in the law of karma, we have to follow the laws of karma. We are in the law of karma. Our having a human body or having a presence in the physical world is a result of the law of karma. You have no karma, you can't be a human being. You can't have a body at all. It is a karma, our actions, our old actions, our old intentions, they are creating a human body and a human life for us. That's the law by which we are experiencing this. So we have to live within that law. And if the law requires that we do certain things in response to what we did earlier, and we have to fulfill that, which means paying off our karma, and we say, no, I don't want to pay off our karma, I want to go to home. You can go home, but the law here requires you pay off your karma. Of course, in home, you'll find out it was all a game. There was no such thing as karma on your soul. Karma was put up in the mind to have an experience of this kind of life, this kind of experience. So therefore, then you have to have an obligation. And we have so much obligations today, more than ever before. We don't have that kind of free time we used to have 100 years ago. So therefore, being so busy with paying of karma, we can't say, let's go and have all the experiences inside, visual experiences, which distract us, and we say karma later, and we can do the meditation first. You can't postpone. If you postpone, you come again for a second life. Actually, some people tell me, after they get initiated, the karma, payoff of karma speeds up, which is good. We have to pay off something. We come up with an account and we want to finish Sanchit Karma. Reserve has been finished already at initiation. We just have a small bit of karma of present life alone left. Now if we create some new karma here, we come again for this short segment that we are creating now. But we have to do it. So one should never worry about this. Now never worry that, oh, I've got so many things to do. Do it. You're paying off your bills. You say, how will you pay our bills? That's how you pay off your bills. These are all payment of bills, old bills that are pending. You didn't pay them last time. You created new ones. That's how you pay them off. Cheerfully pay them off. And be ready to go home. So that is why you cannot always judge in a busy life what your spiritual progress is and overall progress. Overall, inside and outside. So remember that you have to judge always inside and outside if you're making any progress. And eventually, you'll find the more progress you make, the more love, true love and devotion will come automatically inside you. And love and devotion is a very powerful thing. It's not made up by thinking about it. It comes when you're drawn. And the more meditation you do, the more conversations you have with your master inside, love and devotion will grow. Your spiritual growth will keep on taking place, altering your life outside, even if you don't see it. So don't always emphasize on this thing. I have not had a spectacle inside. I could not fly above the sky. I could not go there. Therefore, I am not making progress. That's not true. you can have a limited spectacle and a much more experience of changes in life and more miracles here. So that is why they are all balanced with each other. So do not only judge your spiritual progress from what you can see in the dark sky inside. Of course, it's nice to have inner experiences. I'm not saying that don't have them. I'm saying, but don't judge your spiritual growth only from there. But follow Baba Jamal Singh's example. If you are missing your master, so much you want to see him, as much as you, as quickly as you can, you want to be there, you are making progress. When you will go inside, you will check it out. That's what happened with Baba Jamal Singh. When Swamiji put him into meditation and showed him his state as it was when he wrote the letters, he found out he had been traveling in those areas, blindfolded. He could not see them, but he could feel them. And the feeling was being expressed in his love and devotion for his master. I would like to distribute the prasad today. If somebody is only coming tomorrow, we'll have some left over for tomorrow, but I think we can do it today now. I also want to say that people have asked me in passing, and I think it's important I should tell you, that you tell stories of these BBs. You tell stories of Dr. Ishwar Singh. You tell stories of the mastanas of great master days. Are those days over? Is it only history that you had those people? Or are such people even there today? And I want to tell you, there are as many people here today of the same type as they were at that time, sitting amongst us. There are as many people here who are having the same kind of experiences, the same feelings that these people had at that time. And when Mark closes his recording, I'd like to request a couple of my friends to be introduced to you. I'll introduce you a couple of friends whose experiences are as amazing as the experiences that these advanced souls and mastanas had in great master's time. So don't think that was all history. If it was history, I can tell you history is being repeated right now in this country, right here. So don't think it is just stories I tell you. They are being repeated right now. Thank you very much for your patient listening. And I hope you all enjoyed this Bhandara and you will take this prasad home and take a little bit of it every day as a memory of this event. Thank you. Great Master, bless me with all of you. God bless you.